Well, as Fela would say, let's start what we have come into the room to do.
Jakabere.
Do you know Fela Anikulapokuti? Yeah. Well, if you don't know Fela, after tonight, you go know. Definitely go know tonight. Now, my name is Tani Goma. I'm from PBS FM. Before I introduce the panel, let me just very quickly and more importantly start by acknowledging the traditional owners of the land and pay my respect to the elders, past, present, and future. A big up and much respect to the Wheeler Center for putting this on. It's really great to have this topic here. It's an important one for Africa, but also an important one for the world. Now, it says that Fela no go die, because we believe that Fela was a very important person for the history of Africa, not just the music. I'm going to introduce the panel now, but also big thanks to Paul Houston. You can see there, this event is Auslan interpreted, and later we'll have Linda Donet as well. So big thanks to them for making that more accessible. Thank you. Right, on my left over there, we have Stephanie Kabanyana Kanyandekwe. She's a composer, multidisciplinary artist, and her work revolves around archiving, composition, research-based composition, archiving, and cross-generational conversation. Please make her welcome. Next is Zvi Belling. Now, Zvi is an interesting artist because he does a number of things. He's a bass player extraordinaire, I should say. Founding member of Melbourne-based Afrobeat powerhouse, Public Opinion Afro Orchestra. And in his spare time, he moonlights as an architect and has designed some of the most interesting buildings in Melbourne. Please welcome Zvi Belling. Now, all the way from Lagos, Nigeria, Lemi Garioku. Lemi is known as the king of album covers because he revolutionized the design of album covers. Even though he designed over 2,000 album covers, and the work with Fela is only about 10% of his work, but that's the most important work, and that's what we'll be talking about tonight. So please welcome Lemi Garioku. Now, as a warm-up question to our panel list, we're going to ask them to talk to us about their first encounter with the music of Fela. And by the way, you'll have your opportunity to ask your questions, so hold those questions. And I've asked the panelists to also watch out for the best question, and you'll get a prize for that. So you'll have your chance. But right now, we're going to ask our panelists to share with us their first encounter with the music of Fela. And we're going to start with Stephanie.
I was thinking about this earlier and stretching my brain back to the 90s and what was a very difficult year for our family. I remember attending in the town I grew up in, which is Darwin, a very small African community event. In Darwin at that time, there were 5 African families. We were one of them. And I think my mum still remains the only Rwandan in the Northern Territory. So it's a very, very tight-knit community. But that had great benefits because it meant that any important kind of African event, we were all together and we were celebrating and discussing. And of those who were there, we had some very fascinating people. And there was a South African family. And in 1994, in April, there was the South African elections, and that's where the ANC came to power with Mandela. But also in April in 94 was the start of the Rwandan genocide. So for our family, obviously, that was a very traumatic event. But then, you know, elsewhere on the continent, something completely opposite was happening. So I remember my South African uncle, Uncle Fez, Fezile, held an ANC party. And there was some great South African music played, and I remember knowing all the words to all of the Miriam Makeba songs inside and out, and trying very hard at singing in Xhosa as well. There was also this, you know, kind of new funky beat that I hadn't heard before, and I remember asking my Uncle Fez, saying, who is this guy and what is he saying, because he's not really singing in English. And my Uncle Fez explained to me, he said, oh, that's Nigerian pidgin, it's English, but you know, structured in a different way, and this is Fela Kuti. He's, you know, we're playing his music because he was really politically active, and a bit of an activist, and he was speaking for the people. So, you know, tonight we're thinking about the people who have been emancipated in South Africa, and this type of music will help get us into that mood. So, yeah, 1994 in April, a very difficult time, but that was the first time I came across Fela Kuti.
Nice one. Zvi, what about you? And I'm also very keen to hear at what point you decided that the kind of music that you would like to play.
My first intersection with Fela was as a teenager living in South Africa in the midst of probably apartheid at its peak, but also importantly the anti-apartheid movement at its peak as well. And interestingly, the first Fela song that I can remember, and I probably had heard others, but the one that I can remember was a cover version by Huma Sakela. He did Lady on one of his albums in the I reckon mid 80s, and I loved that tune, not knowing that it was by somebody else. And I researched it further and I found the original, and I sort of delved into it from there. So in a sense, Huma Sakela has also been a huge role model for me. So in a sense, it was through him that I found Fela. When I did first listen to Fela, I was a young aspiring musician, and I was very excited about African music. I found Fela's music didn't excite me in the way it does now. At that time, I actually found the fact that it sat on one chord and its simplicity was a barrier for me at first. I couldn't immediately tackle it, but the rhythm was very exciting. So I stayed interested because of the rhythm. It took me quite a while before I realised that there's so much complexity and there's so much subtlety in what Fela does with one chord beyond that. And actually, it sounds like one chord, but actually there are many hidden inside it. That was probably the beginning of my relationship with Fela's music. And it was only many years later that when I was living in Australia, and probably through some nostalgia for the African music that I'd left behind, that I got the idea that I'd like to perform Fela's music. I never thought it would turn into the band that it has. It really was just a love for the music, and we wanted to play it.
I don't know how many of you went to the concert on Saturday as part of the celebration, commemoration of Fela's 20th anniversary of his passing. How many here actually went to the concert on Saturday? Oh, you should have been there. It was something really, truly, truly special. So I'm very glad that you discovered the music of Fela, and now you're playing. But we'll come back to that. We'll come back to that topic a bit later. Now, our friend Lemmy here couldn't really escape that music because it was in Lagos all the time. But what we would like to talk to you, Lemmy, about, not just the first time that you heard Fela's music, but I'm also very keen to hear from you back when you were known as Emmanuel Sunday, when you first came into contact with Fela and Kulapo Kuti. Tell us a little bit about back in the in the 70s when you presumably came across Fela's music, and then when you went on to become part of his inner circle. But let's start with music first.
It's the first time I'm facing this question, like, when did you find Fela?
Yes.
And I couldn't find Fela. Fela found me.
Yeah.
Fela's music found me because I'm a child of the 50s. I remember very vividly my consciousness with Miriam Makeba. That was in the 60s, and also Millicent Small.
Mm.
But by the same token, the high life music was all around me. Fela was experimenting, so to speak, with high life jazz after returning home from his musical course at the Trinity College in the UK. He had studied classical music, so he had a challenge because predominantly Nigerian musicians were playing high life. It was very trendy versus the Ghanaian musicians. So he had this challenge to compete with what was on the scene. And because he was educated, in music, he couldn't blend in the raw form, in the organic form. So he had this combination of high life and jazz element. And it wasn't very danceable because, you know, Africans love to dance. So I can't even say exactly when I found Fela because the music found me.
Yeah.
We used to have Red Diffusions those days. That's a pre-transistor age. Red Diffusions, a contraption, a brown box. It had just one radio station on it. You pay subscription, it's stuck in front of the building. So the music and the news goes throughout the day, so you just hear. So I'm doing a quick calculation in this moment because I never faced this question before. I'm trying to picture which song of Fela's I remember from my childhood. I think I remember Oni Do Do, Oni Moi Moi. That was very popular. Lai She, Lai Ro. Yeah, that was early 60s.
And that was like sort of Kula Lobitos.
Kula Lobitos. But now, finding Fela.
Mm.
I eventually found Fela by 1970, when he came back from his trip to the United States, he found himself.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I was able to find him in the essence that we speak about him today. He was conscientized in the United States. He got back. He was a changed person. He wasn't interested in the basic social lyrics that pervaded the scene. Generic lyrics. So his first major hit was Jeun Koku.
Mm.
That was a drastic change from his normal pattern of music and then a normal pattern of lyricism. And then he used Pidgin English directly, which was a very good calculation because Pidgin English is spoken predominantly by most Nigerians, even if they are not even literate in the sense of they don't have Western education. They have this amalgam of the local language and English. So I call it Nigerianis. So people come up, different tribes, different ethnic groups have their own portion, version of Pidgin English. Then the ghettos have their own style.
Mm.
Their ways they coin the words. So Fela tapped into that immediately with that song, Jeun Koku, and it was a monster hit.
Mm.
So everybody has to pay attention. So that was when I found Fela. I mean, as the possible militant, possible revolutionary. He wasn't a revolutionary at that point in time, but that consciousness was there. And I had always had an inkling, attraction towards people who made impact, even though I was very young, because I knew very consciously why Miriam Makeba left South Africa during the apartheid time. And I still have her first album she recorded with Harry Belafonte Orchestra in 1966. I love those songs any day. I always have a sense of pride. And that's what I saw in Fela immediately. So that's it.
Well, let's now ask you a question that I'm sure you've been asked many times. And it's one taking you back to 1974 as a young person. Emmanuel Sunday, I mentioned earlier. Clearly very talented. You're able to do certain things. Just for the benefit of people who haven't heard the story of how you actually came into contact with Fela. Do you want to just share that with us?
Okay. Yeah, sometimes I feel like I should record it into a DVD. So when exactly. you ask me, I give you the DVD.
Play it. Yes.
Go and play it.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Let me phrase it quickly.
Yes.
I self-taught as a visual artist. I didn't study art formally, but I learned from sight, asking questions, checking out people, sometimes aping what they've done. Specifically 1974. I was battling with myself and society. Society in the form of my parents, especially my dad. My dad wanted me to be a mechanical engineer, so I was in technical school studying the sciences and technology. I didn't mind because I didn't have a decision to make at that point in my life, but I always loved drawing. I kept drawing. So I finished secondary school in 1973. The interregnum between you get your certificate, you go to university, or you travel abroad. You know, Africans always have traveled abroad. So I had ample time. So I kept practicing and practicing. And then I started going to the television station because I met a musician called Sonny Okosu. Yeah. He took me to the TV station once, and I fell in love with the place. So I go, I do live drawings of the TV presenter, a program presenter, and the guest. So I became popular on TV just on that basis. Like they say, oh, that small boy that used to come and draw. Then I gave myself an assignment. I have to do a drawing a day. Mm-hmm. So at that point in time, I started doing portraits in my neighborhood because I started out drawing people's faces from pictures. So I started earning some money. Then there was a drink place next door to my parents. The owner of the drink place surprised me. He approached me, not for his own portrait. He asked me, he commissioned me to do the painting of Bruce Lee's poster for Enter the Dragon. The film just came out, and it was like these days, I say, blockbuster, Hollywood. So it was so popular. The man could afford to spend money for me to do a portrait of Bruce Lee, John Saxon, and Jim Kelly, which I did. That's item one. In retrospect, I just smiled that it was my destiny that was being programmed through that process. I believe strongly in destiny. Item two, Fela released an album called Music of Fela,
yeah.
Ruff Ruff Fight. That was 1974. So you see his progression. Because by the time he became successful with Jeun Koku and some other songs in the Afrobeat idiom, his consciousness was growing. Then he needed to brand himself and present himself officially. Mm. So the album was a double album, and it was titled Music of Fela, then subtitled Ruff Ruff of Fight. So I got the record. I love it. I listen and listen. Then one day my spirit said to me, you know, because I always look for things to draw every day. I could just do still life. So that day my spirit just said to me, why don't you do your version of this cover, just as practice. So I did that. The song Ruff Ruff of Fight was also a social song. Fela was admonishing two friends who were fighting where it was swampy. And he said to them, you be careful, there is mud around you. And if you end up in the mud, you become like twins. We won't recognize who is who. You know, very hilarious. But I didn't bother about the lyrics. I bothered about the effect the music had on me. Mm-hmm. I felt it was jolly. So I drew Fela dancing, like in celebration, right, on mud. And I put in the graphics. But who is to tell? That was what I was going to do in future. Yeah, I didn't know.
Yes.
So I had that in my collection. There was a journalist working for a Sunday newspaper, weekly newspaper called Sunday Punch. His name is Babatunde Harrison. He loved to drink. So he came to drink in the drink place, and he saw the Bruce Lee poster. So when he saw it, he liked it and asked who did this. And they said, one small boy next door. So he was surprised, small boy did this, okay? And he said he wanted to see me. So they brought him to see me and he asked for my other drawings.
Yeah.
So I brought out the drawings and he saw the Fela cover. And he was really surprised. And he said, that two days to that day, he and Fela were discussing about cover art.
Okay.
I looked at him and I just shook my head like, this uncle is drunk. You know, he's coming from a drink place because I never could imagine he knew Fela.
Hmm.
So, and he said, okay, it was going to be a picture of Fela. Since I do portraits, I should do Fela portrait as my test, and he would take me to Fela. I said, okay, I took up the challenge. Okay. So he brought the picture. 24 hours, I'd finished. My mom was always supportive of my art talent, this discovery or honing. So my mom gave me 5 naira those days to buy, to frame it. It was 18 by 24 inches portrait. So the next evening, I started waiting for the uncle, you know, watching back on the road if he was coming. The moment I saw him, I showed him the portrait from a distance. And he said, oh, I'm not going to drink. I'm taking you to Fela. I thought it was a joke. So so I told my mom, and Fela was very popular, but on notoriety basis, he was very notorious, his lifestyle. Yes. He had not become the revolutionary. He was already a social rebel at the point in time. So my mom said, be careful. I said, yes, ma. And so I got in the taxi with the journalist, and we went and went to Calcutta. And let me just cut it short.
Yeah,
I saw Fela, and he saw the portrait, and he said 2 words. He said, wow, God damn it. That was the first time I ever had those words. And that's how it all started.
Okay, let's look at this now. This is one of your early pieces. It's a very interesting cover in terms of, you know, the subject matter and what you did with. Do you want to tell us a little bit about what was happening at the time and what you were seeking to project on this cover?
Yeah, very interesting. It shows how spiritual my work is. I get inspiration spiritually, so to speak. I don't want to sound cliche, but that's exactly how I work. This is a typical example. The illustration does not reflect the lyrics literally. You can't pick up words from the lyrics from the illustration. The illustration is just abstract, but telling the truth, you know, to the lyrics and the purpose of the song itself and what it denoted in the hemisphere where Fela existed. To link up to my earlier story, after I met Fela, within 3 weeks, there was a police raid in his commune. So he was brutalized. He had a fractured skull. He was taken to the police station, detention, then to hospital. So it was big news. So I waited for Babatunde Harrison again in the evening. As I saw him coming, I asked him, how is Fela? He said that Fela is okay, that he's in hospital, that when he's done with drinking, he was going to go see Fela in the hospital. Would I love to come? I said, yes, yes, eagerly. And he took me. And we got to the hospital. He was in a private room. About 20 odd people were with him. He's always very gregarious. So he was talking, talking ideas. And we moved our way towards the bed so he can notice us because there was a crowd in the room. Eventually, he saw Tunde, who was his friend. So he greeted Tunde, and Tunde pointed at me, and Fela looked at me and said, oh, the artist. And I had this feeling of, you know, very euphoric. I had not done his cover at that point. And that day specifically, I remember Claire's day, he was talking ideas. He said when he comes out from bail and out of hospital, he was going to electrify the fencing around his house that the police gain access to easily. So I was just looking at him like, how? Then he said he was going to write a song about the situation to lampoon the police.
Okay.
So a couple of weeks later, my story needs to be linked up. For the portrait,
yes.
I normally used to earn 30 naira at that period, but he was so happy with the portrait. He didn't know how much I earned anyway. He wrote out a check for 120 naira, which was 4 times what I earned. But my spirit said no. So I gave him back the check. I said, Fela, I don't want money. I give you from the bottom of my heart. And he was very surprised. So he tore out a sheet of paper and wrote out a gate pass. He says, please admit Biara any show free of charge. He used to have 4 shows a week. So I could go to any of the shows free. Later years, people told me it was very rare.
Yeah.
He normally would give a gate pass to a particular show, maybe Tuesday night, ladies night, or Friday. So that afforded me the opportunity to get close to him. So I became close. So immediately started rehearsing this tune. I knew because I had that day in the hospital where he was saying he was going to compose the tune. So eventually he finished and he recorded it. Then one day he looked at me and said, I want to see what you can do for the cover. I said, okay. So I went and did this. Interestingly enough, destiny fulfilled. The image of Fela you see there,
that
was the original image I had in my painting that I did without knowing I was going to meet Fela. That was a celebratory dance on the mud. But, you know, I had to cut off the lower part.
I see.
Yeah. So I eventually pasted it on this painting.
You made a collage.
Yes, I made it a collage just because of that image. It was, you know, preordained that I meet Fela. It was preordained that I played that role with him. So that's where it's playing out. But at the point I was doing that, I wasn't conscious of why I was doing that, but later. So when I did this work, I took it to Fela, the same thing again, said, wow, god damn. And this time he paid me 120 naira.
Okay.
So I collected, I earned that money. But if I wanted to explain this vis-a-vis the music, the lyrics, he was talking about his experience in police detention. He talked about, you know, uniform, na cloth, na tailor, the swam. He tried to demystify the uniform because in Africa, the uniform is so scary. The police and the army, they use the uniform to scare the, you know, the hell out of one. So he said uniform is a piece of cloth. It's also sewn by a tailor. He said, so there's nothing special about uniform. You see, I didn't reflect all that here.
Yeah.
But my image, my painting denoted victory. I looked at Fela as representing the force of good and the police, the force of evil in society. So there is the foreground there, that decrepit building. I used that to represent the jailhouse, Alagbon. Actually, Alagbon Close is the name of the street where the police headquarters in Lagos is. It's still there. So Fela popularized that street name. He called the place Alagbon Close. It's actually called CID Force Headquarters. But he used the name of the street, you know, to label. Until today, all Nigerians, they call that place Alagbon. Alagbon. So I used that to represent. Then I showed that the place was in flames. Fela has broken free. You see half of the chain is still attached to the decrepit building. Then the forces of nature are on Fela's side. There is a big whale. The police patrol boat has been capsized, you know, by the whale. And then Fela's empire, the republic, is standing on solid ground. That's why there is a rock. And the sun is shining behind, you know.
Yeah.
And you see, it does not tell the lyrics, but he accepted it wholeheartedly, and it worked.
And was there any backlash after this particular cover?
Yes, you know the song "Expensive Shit."
Yes,
yeah, came that from was that. The direct backlash.
Now, let me take you to one that is a lot more obvious and a lot more confrontational than that one there. Now, this one is generally regarded as the beginning of big trouble for
Big
Fela.
Trouble, yeah.
And you were responsible for this one.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us a little bit about what was actually happening around this time that led you to take such a bold move in your work. Because I think the previous one, it's fair to say, was not quite as clear cut in terms of the Fela taking on the army. I think this is very clear. That's what, you know,
taking he's on the army, yeah.
Yeah, he's taking them on, and he's literally saying, I'm here, I'm not going anywhere. Mm-hmm. And almost you get the impression that he's almost, in fact, saying that I'm going to bring you down. You know, it's either you or
taunting.
Me.
Yeah.
So I guess the question is, what was going on there that, you know, gave you that level of courage to actually go that far? But more importantly, there is almost a sense that there was no fear of what's going to happen afterwards. So maybe you didn't realize that things could go wrong after that.
Actually, we all around Fela, we had foreboding.
Yeah.
We have foreboding because you can't be dealing with the military in Africa and not have fear.
Yeah.
Yeah, they don't take no prisoners. But the irony of life is that, you know, people are made for purposes, a particular purpose. And that's why we talk about Fela today. That's why in Nigeria, the Yoruba people call him Abamieda, which means the weird one. Because Fela did so many things that were scary that in Nigeria, people still feel like it would take another 100 years to get somebody as bold as Fela. So that boldness people like me were shrouded in Fela's boldness. I have never really seen myself as a revolutionary. I'm not a revolutionary, but I work very well under revolutionary zeal. I love the energy the revolutionaries bring to the table. You know, I'm an evolutionary. I love to be part of the organizers, organize for change to come. You know, build it up, because destruction or the elements we are not happy with in society never came in one day. So I feel strongly, people like me, but people like Fela want the change immediately. So my role was supportive and collaborative. I had confidence in Fela, in his personality, in his stature. That's where my confidence is in. I'm not brave at all if it comes to it. But I was doing this also because I talked about the spiritual. I don't joke with my spirit. Since I've learned to listen to the still small voice within me, if it tells me go jump in the river, I just go jump. So my spirit, if my spirit told me, oh, don't do this, I won't. So that was what my spirit told me the day the military wanted me to come to the probe panel.
Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't go.
But of course, yeah. Then this happened. As a result, this is what happened then. Yeah.
This is the Kalakuta show.
Yes.
This is another serious police raid.
Yes.
This became more interesting because Fela's lawyer was present. That's the guy in Thai, with his law book. His name was Komi Ishola Oshobu. We used to call him people's lawyer because Fela actually attended court like 200 times in his lifetime. And a lot of his income went to legal fees.
Yeah.
This lawyer was very good at getting him out of trouble, but at not at little expense either. But we call him people's law. So that day, the lawyer was visiting and the police came. So the lawyer saw everything. And the case, like always, Fela won the case every time for lack of evidence and all that. So that's the thing. I didn't finish answering about the zombie cover.
Yes.
Actually, at that point in time, every time Fela got beaten up by police or the military, he got stronger. So we get scared, like, this man is not letting go. He gets more, you know, angry, and his weapon is his music. So at this point in time, around when he did the zombie song, when he composed it, he had a lot of intercussions with the military. And he said, now they have not heard anything. Then go hear pansa, pansa. Yeah, that's Yoruba for, like, they will hear, there's no English for it anyway. They will hear, like, more like, crazy stuff.
They've never seen before.
Yeah, so, yeah. And he will now say, because he loved acronyms a lot, he would say, this song, this one is direct attack. It's a DA song. So sometimes when he's composing a new song, we'll ask him, say, Fela, which is it? Is it going to be DA? He said, yes. So he now said, this is direct attack. Those army bastards, I'm going to lampoon them seriously. So he came up with Zombie. But when he performed it at the shrine, everybody would go crazy.
Yes.
But he used the song like to break them down, like they are human beings, and you know, to make parody of them, which was very, very dangerous.
Effective, very effective.
And we saw the effect at the end. So when the song was recorded, he asked me to do the cover. He never gives me directions of what to do. I just do as I please, and he knew, because I shared ideology with him totally. He knew I was all going to be very responsible. I even used to put my picture on the back sleeve. Sometimes I created a column I call designer's comment. The reason being, sometimes the artwork does not relate directly to the lyrics. And I used to go to record shops when Fela's album is advertised in the newspaper, like it's going to be released on 15th of September. That day in the evenings, I'll go to the record shops. People will come. They're looking at the album cover.
Yeah.
Sometimes they get confused when they hear the music. They're feeling like, oh, what the music is saying is not really here. So I started putting designer's comment because I was also an ideologue with Fela. And at that role, I played very well. That's why I was able to work for him so long. Fela is not an easy person to go. So when it came to Zombie, he now said I should do a cover art for it. I was scared. For 2 weeks, I'll go to his place and he would ask me, how far will the cover? I said, I'm still thinking. So I kept thinking, what will I do? What am I going to illustrate? And I'm thinking, I have to be careful. So one day, his in-law, Babatunde Kubuye, came in. He was a fledgling photographer. He had gone to the Independence Day military parade. You know, under the military government, Nigeria's Independence Day is October 1. Mm. So they used to have a big parade in the stadium. So Babatunde Kubuye had gone there, took dozens of pictures, loads of photographs, and he just walked in that afternoon. Me and other friends where we fell out bantering. He came and said, I look pictures where I go take for TBS, that's the stadium. And he threw them on the floor. We started looking, like hundreds of photographs. As we were looking, I just saw, my spirit just said, this is the cover. So, because my style is eclectic, so I could, anything, anywhere I felt. So I picked about 10 pictures. So I got Tunde's permission, took them home, and you know, some organic, did my box, 12 1/4 by 12 1/4. I started editing the photographs and placing them to see how it works. But reminiscent of Ifa divination, you know, the Yoruba traditional religion, like the Delphi, you know, they throw the dice, throw the cowries, and that was the kind of way this played out.
Okay.
The pictures just fell on each other, and immediately my spirit just said, that's it. So I held them down with masking tape, then overlaid, then I used my knife, cut, you know, the one on top, cut down and remove the edges, and I was satisfied choosing this fella photograph. That's he's facing them, even though they look so huge, and fearlessly. So I took the cover to fella, and he saw it. Wow, goddamn!
Again, we'll come back to some more covers in a few minutes. We'll want to bring in some of the other two panelists for a discussion around the approach here. Zvi, as a musician, when you're releasing an album, you do very often go to someone to try and get the album designed. Would you give as much freedom to another artist to represent your work in the way that Fela did with Lemmy?
Yes, it's all about trust. If you trust them and that they understand what your music's about, you have to trust them because words and music are difficult partners, and I think also images and music are difficult partners. They don't line up, and that's why I love Lemmy's approach, because it's oblique. It's not a direct relationship, and obviously he won Fela's trust, and he won it through his art. And so the artists that I've worked with on album covers, I try and do the same, and the artists that we're planning to work with on our next album cover, I've done the same.
Yeah.
He might be sitting next to me.
Nice one. Now, Stephanie, I mean, in some ways, this is a branding exercise, isn't it? I mean, the work between Fela and Lemmy, there's a fair degree of branding there. And even though, the trust and the relationship between them was a very important part of the process, if you were composing music and you wanted to put it out there, would you, again, like Zvi mentioned, would you trust somebody else to have enough insight into the essence of the music to be able to represent it on your behalf?
I feel so. Particularly coming from a composition standpoint, first and foremost, I mean, I'm do perform a little bit and am still a musician, but my brain works in creating the work. There's always levels of interpretation. You know, I write work, I present it to musicians, we workshop together, they perform it. And even though they're technically performing what I have written on a score, it's always going to sound a little bit different to what's in my head. So there's these layers of interpretation. Mm-hmm. And therefore, I think it's important to, if you're a self-reflective composer and and not a control freak. It's important to kind of release yourself into the interpretations of others because you have a lot to learn from it. And so I would happily turn to artists, as I have, in the interpretation of my work to see where their brain space is looking at it.
I don't know whether it's because Lemmy's here, but in my experience, many artists are actually very reluctant to let go, which is obviously doesn't apply to you both here, maybe because Lemmy's here tonight. We're going to talk about another very important topic. I mean, obviously, the music of Fela has enjoyed a lot of, what's the word? It's got a very strong following in the last few years. And in some ways, you know, one of the reasons why we're here is because even 20 years after his death, his music is as relevant, as strong as ever. And I was talking to, in fact, Lemmy the other day, and he reflected on the fact that there are many Afrobeat bands around the world, many celebration events around the world. And it just got me thinking about the whole topic, the whole issue around cultural appropriation. So if we come back to Lemmy first, if Fela, given what you know, how well you knew Fela, and I've read reports that Paul McCartney actually had a very difficult situation where he was accused by Fela of stealing music, and of course they had to try and clarify certain things. Would you say Fela would be very happy to know that there are many bands around the world performing his music in 2017?
Fela wouldn't have a choice than to be happy. He struggled so many years.
Yeah.
For me, there is a slogan he uses when he comes on stage. Everybody say, yeah. To me, I feel like he's trying to test the people that, you know, they're accepting what he's doing. Because a sense of fulfillment pays more than the cash. It's like my experience the last 10 days I've been in Melbourne. All the people I've met, you know, I sign autograph. They tell me, oh, they love my work and all that. That sense of fulfillment is the greatest. It's not if I get back to Nigeria now, somebody is looking at me, maybe I went to bring money from Melbourne. No, it's not about money.
Yes.
So definitely, even though he seemed to be a hard person, he has his soft spot.
But he was very concerned about people stealing from Africa, though. He did say so.
So don't take it literally.
Okay.
Yeah, because...
How should we take it, then?
No, take it pragmatically.
Meaning what?
Yeah, meaning it doesn't have to mean that he meant people stealing that way. Sometimes you see something and it's... viewed out of context. And sometimes it could be the scenario at that particular point in time. Because for me, as a Pan-Africanist like Fela, that's where we totally agree.
Yeah.
I have different characters from Fela entirely. But when it came to the ideology and how to propagate and how to help towards mental liberation of our people, that's where we are totally in sync. Mm. We would love, you understand, to see that our culture also is respected and emulated and copied globally, like we've been aping and copying the West.
Mm.
So I don't see why Fela should not feel happy.
Okay.
If, at this stage in time, 2017, probably in the US alone, I know at least 15 Afrobeat bands. I've been doing covers in the last 5 years on a global level. I don't even do much cover for people in Nigeria because the young people, they are just hip-hop crazy.
Mm.
So so they don't have a lyrical content that I will illustrate. So that makes me happy. I get a call from, imagine, Ireland. I didn't even know much about Ireland. I love to vibe. And the guy tells me, oh, Nigeria is celebrating independence. We too, we were under Britain. We are celebrating 100 years of independence. I said, you too?
Yeah.
And you are white like them, you know?
Uh-huh.
So that's interesting. And he said, we love Fela's music. We love your artwork. We want a cover. The group is called Bangura Band. Anyone can Google now. You know, these days you can't lie. Just check. So you understand?
Yeah.
I did a cover also late last year for a group called The Brooks Far Away Canada. You understand? Mm. They love Fela's music. They love the message. It resonates. Because at the end of the day, all human beings are the same.
Mm.
You know, all these divisions that we put in place that causes frictions, it should go. All of us bleed red. Mm-hmm. We are the same. So I really don't see any
you don't
point
see the division. Fela not being happy. So let's bring Zvi into this now. I mean, you play in an Afrobeat band and you play some of Fela's songs. Was there ever a time when you felt that that potentially could be an issue in terms of it being labelled or viewed as cultural appropriation?
Yes, I've thought about it a lot. And as of today, I don't have to think about it anymore. I think Lemmy just gave me a free pass, yes. Direct from Fela. When we started the Public Opinion Afro Orchestra, and our mission was very clear, we wanted to perform Afrobeat, and we wanted to perform it as true to the idea of Afrobeat as we possibly could. For us, it was about, if we're going to do this, then we need to do it with authority and we need to do it with respect. And the idea crossed our minds that perhaps we have to even do it with permission.
Mm.
And with that in mind, the founders of the group, Tristan and Ethan and myself, we travelled to Lagos and we went and hunted down the Kuti family and we met with them, we played them our music and we tried to learn from them and tried to absorb and understand what this Afrobeat was. It was actually, it was a wonderful experience. I'm not sure we actually got permission, but we came back inspired and ready for the journey.
Now, Stephanie, you as a composer, particularly one that does a bit of work around archiving and research, what's your perspective on what you've just heard?
Well, to be honest, I have mixed feelings,
yeah.
About all of these things. And I think the difficulty around cultural appropriation is it's always very specific. You can never be broad spectrum with the application of anything when it comes to applying the ideas or working with the ideas of another culture. And so it's always a negotiation. It's really great to hear that Zvi and Ethan and Tristan thought about permission and seeking permission and travelled over there to speak with the family. I think appropriation and approval can be two separate things that are often confused. So even when one is approved, how do you continue to maintain an authenticity at a level that continues to deserve that approval? And so I think, therefore, it becomes a continual conversation between groups. So in this instance, you know, between public opinion and, say, the Shrine and the Kuti family. So to maintain a dialogue is always really important. But also when you're taking the cultural work of a group and playing it in another context, mm-hmm. so playing Fela's music in Australia, yeah. in a Western country, to audiences who largely are not Nigerian, there becomes a level of responsibility to education also involved. So I think it's really important to break down appropriation with often what can be quite simple steps, and that is to be as open as possible, to assume everybody knows nothing in the nicest possible way, and to talk about, you know, why we're doing this, why we're presenting this music, how it's relevant now, and what it means, and where, you know, this energy goes to. So I think if you're kind of continually active rather than going, yep, okay, I've got my stamp, Lemmy's told me I can do it now. you know, so this is possibly my challenge to Zvi, but I'm sure, you know, he and the guys would do that anyway. I think it's looking at how you continually are active in making sure that you're not appropriating and finding ways to be celebrating with everybody's consent and understanding.
Can I say something?
I'm just very mindful of time. We'll come back to you. Let me just let's address, because we've got to give people the opportunity to Do you want to take that permission back? Is that what you want to do? You want to that approval back? You want to take
it back? It's very important. It's a make or break now.
The other issue, you mentioned earlier, Lemmy, that Fela was a very complex person. And one of the often debated issues around Fela is his attitude towards women. And so as we celebrate his legacy, as we listen to his music and reflect on what he represented, the question I have for all three of you, I mean, how does a young person, particularly a young woman in 2017, engage with the legacy of Fela Anikula Pukuti? And I'll try and get you to do that very quickly so we have enough time for the questions from the audience. Stephanie.
But this is really difficult because clearly we're sitting here looking at what no one can argue is you know, a really great body of work. No one can argue against it. Like, it's significant, the impact that Fela and his music has had. However, I guess when you're looking at someone as somewhat of an ideological leader, you want to have a confidence that they are living true to those words. You don't want to find anything that makes you feel like they could potentially be hypocritical.
Yeah.
And, you know, certainly when I was first listening to Fela, I was listening to all the popular songs that you know, like the bigger hits. And it's over time that I started to listen to the B-sides. And, of course, as anyone who's a music buff would know, like, the devil is in the detail and the B-sides is where there's some crazy things.
Mm.
And recently, a couple of years ago, I listened to a track called Mattress.
Yeah.
And Mattress is the B-side for...
Noise for Vendomouth.
For Vendomouth, which is a 1975 release, where Fela basically describes women as mattresses.
Mm.
And this is 3 years before his famous or infamous marriage to
27
women who were part of the compound and his backup singers and dancers. And it really perplexed me, and it hurt me in a way, because, you know, like so many great people that we can think of in recent times, you might have these heroes, and then when you hear them say something that is so base and be so joyful about it, that struck me somewhere. And there's a refrain where he says to his backup singers, you know, Tell me what you call this type of comfort, it's the women who say mattress. And for me, looking at Fela, he was against levels of oppression, huge levels of oppression, and yet there's this discussion which he's engaging with that is a form of oppression of women. And we know anecdotally and from you know, people who worked with him, that Fela had a really crazy and warped sense of humour at times. So one would like to kind of give him a hall pass and say perhaps he was having a joke. But there's just too many stories and instances of negative discussion around women. And arguably, Lady is another example of that. I don't think it's actually a feminist anthem. I think it's quite the opposite. So, you know, one needs to kind of think, okay, well, how far does that ideology go, and how far does one live that? And then does that change how you accept that music?
Yeah.
You know,
does it?
It's a question. Well, it did
an important question.
Give me pause to think, and I think it's something that everyone should think.
Important response. A quick response from Lemmy. Quick one, please, so we can give them the opportunity to...
How quick can it be for this controversial one?
Yeah.
Okay. Interesting. My sister here has just expressed it. I've heard this over and over again in the UK, in the US. You know, the women, they're just upset. But, you know, culture is different everywhere. Culture is supposed to be dynamic anyway, but this typical African male, you know, male chauvinistic culture. It's tradition. It's been there for years, for ages. I'm not covering up for Fela because I don't think that way. I don't work that way. But for Fela, he was a person that was bold. He would just do whatever he wanted to do. He didn't care about people. But on the defensive side, for people like my sister, you don't need to let those two or three tracks upset you. There is so much work the man has done. But I will point out the positive side that may not be on record for you to see. If you watch the documentary about Fela, either Music is a Weapon or Teacher Don't Teach Me Nonsense.
Yeah, I've seen them both. Yeah.
You saw how he gave credit to a woman who opened his eyes to ideology. That is a very brave thing for Fela to have done, because Fela didn't have element of humility at all. You understand? He's not humble. He's not a humble fellow. Yeah. But because Fela respected women also by the same token that you feel, you know, she put them down, by that same token, he respected them so much. Fela told the whole world how Sandra opened his eyes. I said earlier, Fela wasn't ideological. He was just happy-go-lucky Nigerian high life singer. But Sandra Isidore was his girlfriend in Los Angeles. She was a member of the Black Panther movement. And Sandra had interaction with the police. And that African male chauvinistic thing made Fela look at and felt like, if a woman can challenge the police in Los Angeles, then I might as well be a strong man. And it came from the fact that he was composing a tune called Obe. It means soup. So Sandra asked him, what is the meaning of the song? Because the song was in Yoruba, typical high life. And Fela explained that, I can't eat pepper without soup without pepper, just like me. That's African man. And Sandra said, of all the things going on with black people in the world, is that what you're singing? Yeah, so he became embarrassed. And he picked up the challenge and said to Sandra, you have not read about Malcolm X, Kwame Nkrumah, Marcus Garvey? And Fela said, show me a book. It's in the documentary. It's documented. So please, use that to balance up. Because that shows you, you know, human beings, we show contrariety sometimes. We have this, you know, confusion sometimes the way we behave. That's one. Number two, Fela venerated his mother.
Most African men would venerate their mothers. That also is a cultural thing.
But no, it depends. It depends. If you are very extremely chauvinistic, you will not want to do it publicly. So some extra chauvinistic men will not say you are weak. You get where I'm coming from. So today, because of that, the whole world respects Sandra. Fela's family are the hardest to deal with. If Fela had not said it himself, Sandra would not be able to talk. If Sandra said, I was the one who exposed Fela, they would tell her, shut up. But because Fela said it and put it on record, Sandra is giving that due respect. Then, talk about the 27 wives, the marriage. I was partly involved in the decision. The reason was, you know, Fela was a showman. He was conscious of branding. He branded himself. He made his own shoes. He had his own shoemaker. He sold his clothes, even his briefs. He never bought ready-made. So he has his dance style, his music, created a musical form. So he was a very conscious marketer. So by the time it got to a level, the whole society, you know, were labeling those girls. So it became very bad for them. And they went through hell with him. They got all the beatings with Fela.
I'm actually not against. And we sat down. The marriage
and
of the
one
wives.
Time, Fela was saying, "Oh, these girls, they've gone through a lot." That was after they burned the house. And he thought in African society, the best way to compensate them would be for them to take his name. He married them, so they are married. In Africa, a woman that is married, you start to call her madam, even if you are older than her. That's the culture.
Let me, sir. I'm just very mindful of time.
Yeah.
I know it's a very
important... You didn't give us enough time.
So please,
putting you on notice.
Please, be mindful of that positive side.
But it's
take your role as a queen. He called them my queens. And he said, don't call them whores. They are my wives now. They are my queen. They are my family.
So, but I would like to maintain that African women can be queens without being married and being single. And I would say that as much as yes, you can take on balance that he did amazing things. It's also okay to look at someone who is human and who might have made mistakes.
Yeah.
You know, so I think that it's still okay to accept when people have done, you know, different things. And he's not around now to talk about how he might have changed and how he did change later in life. So.
Well, I'll spare you this discussion, Zvi. I know you probably have a fair bit to say, but we'll leave you alone on this one. We do have time for, oh, goodness me, a few questions there. So how about we take them all at once and then we'll try and answer them rather than sort of toing and froing. So, yeah, we'll get
and
all
remember,
the questions.
Remember, good questions get rewards.
Exactly. Don't so we'll give you the opportunity to
we have some secret prizes.
Ask all your questions and we'll try and address them at the same time.
I was in Nigeria at the time when Fela was making such an impact. And a couple of things I'd like to say. There was a huge amount of respect and delight among the intellectual Nigerians as to what he was doing. He was standing up to the army. He said, they are dumb, they are thugs, they are monkeys. And people didn't dare say that. And Fela was terrifically respected and admired for that. Now, the other thing is about women. If you want to look into Fela's family history, his mother was the firebrand. He came from a very well-educated family. They were all doctors. And his mother had gone through hell and high water opposing the military before he did. And that is what influenced Fela. And this thing about marrying the 27 women, he did that to protect them. I was there. I was reading the papers daily. Mm-hmm. And I have to say that the importance of Fela was, in Africa, he stood up to the military. He didn't respect them. And that meant a lot. He did it as an individual. He said, I can do what I like, I'm free. But that meant a lot more than his music. Because I remember this very clearly at the time of the 70s. But I don't have any fears about Fela's feelings about women. If you look into his history and learn about his mother, you see that's where he's got all his ideology and so on from.
Thank you. Next question.
Yeah, hello. Can you tell us a little bit about Fela's brother, Biko? And how they may have worked together. Very little was heard about Biko, but he was a human rights activist
and
he paid the price as well, didn't he?
A doctor. Yeah.
Sure. We take one more question, if there is one, please.
Yes, I'm just wondering about the importance of Fela's encounter with the music of James Brown when he went to LA, in particular, harmonically. Thanks.
Okay.
That's a good question.
One final question, very quickly, if there is one. No? Okay. Let's come back here. Obviously, the first one was a comment. Do you
care to?
No, the first one was.
The first one was
a comment.
A comment.
Pretty much, yeah. And you agree with. Because
yes,
I heard you clapping.
I would vote for the person to get the prize.
Okay, good, good, good. That's good. Now, the second question was about the brother. I think you're the only one that can answer that question.
Yeah, I didn't get the question.
The question was maybe an update on where is the brother, because his brother, who's a doctor, I think he's the one
I think
actually
it's more to do with the relationship between Fela and his brother.
And his brother.
Not much is known, but there's a little bit of inference around Biko working with Fela in some way.
Well, it wasn't
the question.
The question, if we go back to the question, what was the question, in fact?
If they worked together, I mean, his brother was a big human rights activist, so, and obviously, I just wondered if Fela was influenced
together.
By his brother or vice versa.
Yeah, they did work together, but more importantly, they had this sibling rivalry going within them since they were young, because the oldest was the Minister of Health, the Professor Olukoye Ransom-Kuti, was 10 years older than Fela, and Fela was 1 year older than Biko. So the two of them always do pranks together. It was Biko that actually first went to England, because Biko was smarter in school than Fela, and they used to compete. They did compete in a positive way. So they worked together so much that it was Biko that instigated the move that led to Fela being released from jail after he was incarcerated for 5 years. After like 18 months in the prison, he was ill. He was in the prison hospital in Maiduguri in the north. The judge that actually jailed him had his own father also in that hospital. So the judge went visiting and he saw prison warders. So he was asking them, what are you doing here? Is there a prisoner here? And they said, oh, fella is here. And the judge said, oh, can I say hello to him? So the judge went to say hello to fella. I think like he probably said, he said his hands were tied, you know. So the moment the judge left, fella sent for Beko immediately and told Beko. And Beko said, oh, don't worry. So Beko went, organized the press, held a press conference, a world press conference, and blew out that story. And it embarrassed the government of Babangida then. So they didn't have any option. They quickly released fella and sacked the judge. So they did work together effectively. And, you know, the brother was also into active politics in the sense that the Campaign for Democracy organization, the brother was one of the foundation members. And during the Abacha regime, he was jailed. And I remember fella had warned him that he should be careful of Abacha, that Abacha takes no prisoners. And he said to his brother, don't let Abacha catch you. And when Abacha caught him, you know, he was jailed. He was even sentenced to death. He was just fortunate that he got out of it. And on the spiritual level, too, they're very connected. Because fella died on Beko's birthday. Yeah, that's how strong the connection.
Well, we've run out of time, unfortunately.
Hang on, so there was one last question.
Well, the question was about James Brown.
Harmonically.
Zvi, do you want to address that one?
Okay, I'll try and I'll give it a go. I think that fella found James Brown's music secondhand. It wasn't directly from James Brown. And Lemmy's going to help me here. But fella in his early career had a rival in Ghana who was very famous for emulating James Brown's music in the late 60s. And I think fella absorbed the tricks, the musical tricks that James Brown had at that time in a way to better and defeat his rival. Ultimately, he did meet James Brown, but I think in the early formative times, I think he moved away from having chord progressions, which came out of the high life jazz compositions, into more long form and more single key chord structures. And I think I said before, it sounds initially like all the music is in a single key, but if you look inside subtly, there are multiple chords all moving around in sequences. And I think, I'm sure James Brown's music played a part in him getting to that.
It's a similar trajectory. Structure.
Yeah, actually, the guy was Gerardo Pino.
Yes.
He wasn't from Ghana, he was from Sierra Leone. Yeah, so he was mimicking James Brown almost perfectly, and he had big equipment. That really gave fella some fears, and he worked very hard at it. That's the nature fella has. He loved challenges, and he would go head on. And it actually eventually paid off his music.
Well, we've gone over time. We thank you very much for your patience. Thank you for coming tonight.
Visit wheelercentre.com for the best in books, writing, and ideas from Melbourne, Australia, and the world.